did that. This was because Graeme gave this talk earlier, and he found the most embarrassing picture of me he could think of. And amazingly, this is the most embarrassing picture of Sergey anybody's ever taken. But this is Graeme at QIP in Australia 10 years ago, looking very fit. So this is going to be about virtual qubits, where you use classical computers to emulate qubits. I had a friend whose pet peeve was the word virtually. She said, if something's virtually free, what it means is it's not free. So anytime you hear virtually, you think not. So that's just sort of a warning. So the idea came to us in a bar when Graeme was in the bathroom. He made sure I should, and I was still not sure whether he had the idea in the bathroom or I had the idea not in the bathroom or there was some coherent superposition. But when he came back, we had this wonderful idea. And the motivation is the following. So everybody knows that classical computers are very advanced. We have laptops that can do amazing things. We have supercomputers that, you know, have a million processors and terabytes of RAM, and we can simulate things with them very nicely. Whereas quantum computers kind of look like this. And, you know, there's just a bunch of fridges and a bunch of experimental things, and this has probably got 4 qubits in the fridge there. So it's still in a very infantile stage. That's not the right word. Infancy. Maybe both. But we also know that quantum computers are hard to simulate. So this is not going to be news to anybody, but the obvious way to simulate them, and which seems to be sort of the best thing to do, is all you have to do is keep track of a vector that's length 2 to the n. And the elementary gates are just 1 qubits and c0. At least that's one way to do a universal set. And these are sparse, so it's not too bad. All you have to do is do 2 times 2 to the n multiplications for each gate in your circuit, so you end up with the length of the circuit times 2 to the 2 to the n. And if you can just do that many multiplications, you can do any quantum computation you want on a classical computer. And of course, this isn't practical because these numbers, like 2 to the n, get big fast, and we'll probably never be able to simulate more than, say, 50 qubits. Maybe there'll be some tricky techniques. We do 60, 70, I don't know, but it's never going to be more than that, unless it all collapses and somehow it's easy to simulate quantum computers, because almost nothing you can actually prove ever, as you know. So what we wanted to think about was, what if you use these two things together? You use this infantile quantum computer with just a few qubits, maybe 50 in the next 10 years, say, and a supercomputer that can simulate maybe 50 qubits. And the question is, when you put them together, can you simulate using the help of two different kinds of 50-qubit machines? Can you do something that's worth 100 qubits? And before we started thinking about it, all we knew how to do was that, well, that using both of these things together, you could simulate 50 qubits. So there was no obvious way to connect them. So that's what we called the virtual qubit question. It's that given a small quantum computer, a big classical computer, can you emulate having a bigger quantum computer? So this may seem like and the answer is, of course, I wouldn't be standing here if the answer was no. So, although in the most sort of demeaning, weakest way possible, we get a positive answer. Now you might think this is just sort of an academic question, but it's actually very practical. IBM and other companies are trying to build quantum computers, and they may build, say, a 100-qubit quantum computer, but maybe we'll have a client who comes along and says, I've got this algorithm and it needs 101 qubits to run. And so if you have a 101-qubit quantum computer, that's fantastic. But if you just spent $20 billion of the government's money building a 100-qubit computer, and the architecture is all built, and the chips are all etched, and it's all in the fridge, maybe you can't add one more qubit. So then what do? It's a disaster, right? The whole, you know, world economy collapses. So, of course, the idea is, can we use a classical computer to save the day? So the setting is reminiscent of several other settings that I didn't manage to make a slide for in time, but just things that it's similar to. This may remind you of things like DQC1, where you have a small number of qubits, namely 1 perfect qubit, and a large number of terrible qubits. So a classical computer can be viewed as very noisy qubits. Now, for DQC1, you need actually quantum control over your noisy qubits, so this isn't exactly the same. It's also reminiscent of things like blind quantum computing, where you have a client who's classical and he's talking to somebody who has a quantum computer and trying to verify things. So it's in sort of a framework that's been around for a while. But we think the question itself is new. Okay, so before I tell you how it works, I have to tell you one annoying definition, which is why our result is kind of weaker than we'd like it to be. It's only going to work for D-sparse circuits. What we call a D-sparse circuit is just you look at every bit in your unitary that you're trying to do, the quantum computation you're trying to do, and you just count how many times it interacts with other qubits. And each one adds one. So if in this case, this is a two-sparse circuit, if all the other ones are also sparse. The reason we're going to need to do this is sort of annoying. It's because when we start adding in the classical simulation, we're going to have to sort of keep track of all the things that go wrong if we sort of, we're going to peel off this qubit and try and replace it with our classical processing. And it's going to have to be, it's sort of like a sexually transmitted disease. Anything that it's ever come into contact with is also maybe sick and has to call up all its partners and tell them that there's a problem. But luckily, it's not as bad as what they used to say, which is that, you know, everybody that they've had contact with, you have to worry about too. You don't have to go to the second step. So that saves this whole thing and lets it work as well as it does. I think we can make it work with just the ones that you peel off. But for some reason, we never wrote it that way. But I think it actually does work, because it just is the ones you peel off. OK, so it's important to note that these D-sparse circuits are sort of disappointingly weak, but they're actually not useless. They're not trivial. It includes all depth D circuits. And depth D circuits are hard to do on a classical computer, unless BQP is contained in AM, which I don't know whether people think that's true or not. Let's have a show of hands, but I don't think it would prove anything. But anyway, depth D equals 3 is easy, and it was shown by Terhall and DiVincenzo in 2002 that depth D equals 4 is hard. So this includes things that are hard for classical computers. Another thing is what was originally called instantaneous quantum computation, but actually is just something we heard a talk on the other day about commuting Hamiltonians. Commuting Hamiltonians are very low depth, but are hard to sample on a classical computer unless like the whole polynomial hierarchy collapses or whatever it is. And finally, there are log depth circuits for Shor's algorithm, which is fantastic and makes us think like, well, it made us think for a little while that everything was going to be great and this would really be useful. But there's a big but, like in the rump session. The problem is that, of course, to make it log depth, you have to take the original Shor circuit and add on more auxiliary qubits. And this is a whole game about trying to save qubits, so it's not actually helpful for that. But at least the sparse things are not completely trivial. So this is the main result, and it contains a slight brushing under the rug of several things. But what it says is, if you have some n, which is just going to be the number of qubits, and you have a sparse circuit, that you want to run on more qubits, n plus k, you can simulate it with a different D-sparse circuit with a small offset of 3 on just the original n qubits that you had. And you have to do it many times, but this is exponential in only k and d, not in n. And the k and d comes from k is how many qubits I'm adding on, and the d is this sexually transmitted disease factor. And then you also have to do a lot of classical processing, which is also exponential in K and D, but only polynomial in N. So this is just a picture of this. I have N qubits, and I want to turn it into N minus K virtual qubits and K N minus K real qubits and K virtual qubits. And I apologize. Somehow the paper says it differently than my slide. Here I'm adding on k, and here I'm subtracting k from the quantum part, but you know, it's the same thing. Make an n prime and try to move on with life. And so if this would go away, it would say, excuse me. Terrific. Why is it that I don't know how to use a Mac? OK. staying away from it. Anyway, so the point of this is that if Are you kidding me? Okay, the point of this is that if D and K are both small, like order constant, then this whole thing runs in polynomial time in N, plus on both the classical and quantum sides. So we've actually achieved what we wanted. We peeled off some qubits and are able to simulate it with a reasonably sized classical computer and our smaller than necessary quantum computer. But it's still sort of the weakest thing you could hope for that would happen. We have these D-spar circuits and we can only peel off a small number of things. On the other hand, that's also kind of the strongest thing you might expect, because after all, if I could peel off all of them, then I would just be simulating things on a classical computer, and I know I can't do that. So to understand how we set this up, we decided that it was easier to think about things with what we call a standard quantum processing with classical post-processing. And it's obviously equivalent to a regular BQP kinds of things. But we want to always start with a state initialized in all zeros and the ground state. And then there's some quantum computation that we want to do, and we just say that the input to the circuit is going to be encoded in which unitary we do rather than in these inputs. And this is just conceptually easier for us. And then after this unitary, you just measure all the things in the computational basis and then do some polynomial classical algorithm, which just spits out, let's say we're doing a problem that says the decision problem, it spits out a 0 or 1. And that's just testing membership in some set, whether the answer you got was in the set or not, is the answer to your quantum computation decision problem. So the first idea we had was, let's just take each of the qubits we're going to try and peel off and fix their value as both a 0 and a 1. And then maybe we think about doing a plus and a minus or something to have a full basis of operators instead of just states, and evaluate both branches on the classical computer. So it would sort of double each time. But if we only peel off k qubits, then that's OK that we're exponential in that. But the problem is that the qubits change each time you touch them. That's what the d-sparsity is for. And the other problem is that the branches have to actually interfere. So this basic idea doesn't work directly. But something very much like it does. OK, I have this blank again. So the better idea is we're going to express the acceptance probability of our whole circuit as a contraction of tensors. And we're going to make sure that that our entries of tensors can be evaluated on only n minus k qubits, and make sure that we can do the contraction efficiently. So just as an example of the kind of thing you do in the simplest case, so we've got some circuit. This is going to be a one sparse circuit. There's a C0 here and then some unitary. And we're going to eventually want to peel off this top qubit. So we're going to expand the C0 in the Pauli basis. That's all this says. So Paulis are an operator basis. You can figure out what the C's are. They're simple for the C0, but we didn't bother to write it down. So we're just going to think about this thing as a sum. And so it's going to be a sum of terms like this. There's some Pauli here and some Pauli there. And if we can evaluate all of these branches somehow with our quantum classical hybrid computer, then we'll get the answer that we eventually want. So we're going to imagine peeling this off and replacing these circuits now with a new circuit V, which acts only on this small space, and a new circuit W, which acts on the big Hilbert space. And then we're going to replace the V with the classical computing. So we just need to get the acceptance probabilities in terms of these V's and U's. The U and T were the subscripts of our sum over the Pauli operators that we expanded the C0 in. I don't know what happened to the fonts here, but just measure. You're supposed to measure an I and a Y. And those together will be the output that you then check the acceptance probability of. So we're going to try to evaluate these. And before I went out last night, I was raring to go to show you how this works. But the main point is that that the acceptance probability that we want, which is just this sum, we're going to sum over all strings x that are in the set of things that should be accepted. W is our big circuit. Which for some reason used to be called U, unfortunately, I'm sorry, but it's the circuit on the original quantum computation we want to do. And we're going to decompose it into a sum over a product of an A and a B, where the A is this thing, which acts on this V circuit, which is the little one that's going to be on the classical computer. And the B is this funny thing, which is what the quantum computer is going to evaluate. And both of these circuits are going to be D sparse, or maybe D plus 3 sparse. And one of them is going to be on the small number of qubits that we peeled off. And the other one's going to be on the rest of the qubits. And I'm brushing under the rug a couple of things. There's a things like this plus 1. I've peeled off k qubits. The plus 1 is because later on we're going to need to be able to do phase estimation to actually get out the probabilities that we want, because they're not just probabilities. This is an outer product between an inner product between an omega alpha and an omega whatever the other, the different beta that comes after alpha, right? So this is like a cross term. It's going to be the interference term. So we're going to need to do phase estimation, so we sort of have to peel off an extra qubit to do phase estimation and have it around as a helper. So showing that you can write things in this tensor form and then contract it is very straightforward. It's just simple algebra. Here's, I'm just plugging in the definitions of what the square is, and then I'm going to insert the definitions of V and W, small ones. This is terrible notation. Why did we do this? So W is the big circuit of the whole quantum computer, and the W sub alphas are the parts on the little piece that's after you've peeled it off. But anyway, so this is just algebra. You just plug in, and then we move this sum inside, and then this term is exactly A, and this term is exactly B. So these are just things we need to evaluate. And obviously what we're going to do is we're going to run phase estimation on this big W part on the quantum computer. And this is just something, the Hilbert space only goes up to k plus 1 dimensions, so it's going to be something reasonable to do on the classical computer. This is all about doing the phase estimation. And the point of it was that this thing that we wanted to actually measure is as I said, it's not just an observable, it's the off-diagonal terms. So what you do is you do phase estimation on, you prepare the state omega alpha and the state omega beta applied to zeros. You make a superposition of them, and then you're going to run the quantum algorithm and do phase estimation to get something that is a probability. And then these terms are things that are also probabilities, so we can run the quantum computer and compute them. And then we can, you know, use simple math that this probability that we calculated minus this one will give us this real part of the thing that we want. And we can do it again with a different superposition up here and peel out the imaginary part. And so after we've done all that, and if you keep track of how many times you need to sample to get a good approximation of the things you want, it comes out to the number stated in the original theorem, which also had brushed under the rug the epsilons. It just said it's good enough, but what it meant was that you have an epsilon approximation of the answer that you want. Okay, so how well did we do? Well, let's compare it to a lower bound, which says, you know, the most we could possibly expect to peel things off. So of course, as I said, there's no unconditional results. Maybe you can simulate a quantum computer classically. But you can go through this simple counting multiplication argument I started out with and say, okay, well, if we want to do a quantum computer on a classical computer, it takes 2 times L times 2 to the n classical computation time. But if I can peel off an L minus 1, if I can peel off 1 qubit and then emulate it without more than doubling the time, then I can just iterate this process all the way down until I've simulated classically a quantum computer in polynomial time. So that means that the exponent has to be at least, or the base has to be at least 2. Simulating using a classical computer to simulate a quantum computer in this naive way has to take like 2 to the n time. So how well did we do? Well, if you work it out, we got something that is exponential in k and exponential in d and epsilon, for some reason, have a font problem. One of these twos here is an epsilon, and the other one is that it's squared. So this number, you will note, is significantly larger than 2. So we haven't come anywhere close to the bound. So there's a lot of room for improvement, even for D-sparse circuits. 5 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. All right, so just an application for this whole idea, which we haven't fully worked out, but we're hoping is true, is the characterizing a noisy quantum computer, or perhaps verifying that you have a quantum computer, coming back to these kinds of blind quantum computing games. So maybe you have a quantum computer and you don't know whether it's actually working right. So one thing you might imagine doing is breaking it up in this way that we've been talking about, making most of it your quantum computer, but I left off one qubit from the corner, using our classical computer to simulate the ones we've peeled off, and then see if you get the same statistics that you were supposed to, or that you did when you ran the real quantum computer. And you could try peeling off different ones, and this would probably tell you something about where your quantum computer is going wrong if they disagree. You could identify which qubit is wrong without knowing anything else.
It's like replacing the faulty light on the
Christmas tree, exactly. Except instead of plugging in a light, you're plugging in this, right. Big supercomputer to each spot. Yeah, well, you'd like to do it with light bulbs, but you don't have ones that you trust. So, yeah. All right, so I'm going to give a summary, and then I'm going to say a couple things after it. We wanted to emulate a bigger quantum computer with a smaller one in a classical machine. We do it with this tensor contraction trick. The scaling in terms of how many qubits we peeled off is sort of expected. It should double each time, right? But the scaling in the depth may not be optimal, and we hope it's not. Really, the question we started with is still open, though, which is, can I remove a qubit from an arbitrary quantum circuit with less than 2 to the n effort? And we only know this for these d-sparse things. Just quickly, with my last remaining bit of time, there's another whole section of our paper, which is really mostly due to Sergey. I'd like to think that it was inspired by our stupid trivial lower bound, because this lower bound is not a lower bound at all. You can do better. And what Sergey was able to show in a different computational model, which is going to be called poly-based computation. So what you do is you start with a magic state, and then you just measure polys, poly expectation values, and you get a spin one, then you take a branch, and you just sort of follow this branch of measurements along, and it tells you what the next measurement is. But you're just measuring eigenvalues, so you can keep doing it. And at the end, you get some string of zeros and ones, and then a short classical computation will give you the answer. And there are several theorems we have, which is, first of all, this is equivalent to the circuit model using Clifford and T gates, but you may need to add on some more gates for the poly model. You can peel off qubits in just the same kind of way that we can in our other model, and we don't have this D problem. On the other hand, we had to add on qubits to convert from the circuit model to the poly-based model. But the sort of big thing that is surprising is that a poly-based computation on n qubits can be simulated in 2 to the alpha n poly time, but alpha is not 1, it's 0.94. So 2 to the alpha is therefore smaller than 2. Thank you. So I'm not going to really tell you how he proves any of this, but what it comes from, especially this last part, is that you can decompose magic states, or any states, of course, but you can decompose magic states in particular as superpositions of stabilizer states. And we define a stabilizer rank, which is just the smallest value of how many stabilizer states you need to put in a superposition to get the state. And the conjecture, which maybe he's proved by now, is that magic states are the lowest stabilizer rank of anything that's not a stabilizer state, because of course they have rank 1. And because the rank is lower than full, you get this advantage. And actually, you should probably see Bravyi and Gossett's talk in the next QIP, because they get this down to 0.75 and also do it more directly for Clifford and T-gate circuits and get an exponent less than 1 for them as well. So I think I'm out of time. So, thank you.
Sorry, because today we were delayed, so maybe just one quick question for John, okay? Just one question, if any. Yeah, there is one.
Why is it that you can't use a classical simulation of a quantum computer to play the role of the quantum computer here? For instance, if you have a, you know, you can simulate 50 qubits classically, why can't you use another classical computer with your technique to push the computational power further?
Well, that's partly because it's exponentially bad in the K and the D, so as soon as you start pulling them off, like, it just doesn't add up right. And this has a bunch of